you don't have any secular knowledge, doesn't matter much. But then if you want to realize spiritual knowledge, then you should have character. That is what Kathopanishad says. Na virato duscharitat, na shanto na asamahita. This Atman cannot be realized by a man of bad character, duscharitat. So if you have to lead mankind, the first and fundamental thing, that is what Yama Niyama Patanjali says, Yama Ahimsa Satya Asteya Brahmacharya Aparigraha Shaucha Santosha Tapa Swadhyaya Ishvara Pranidhanani. So these are the moral and ethical values. Without having values in life, how can you dream of the realization of the highest goal? So Sri Ramakrishna was very particular that his disciples should have this, and even Swamiji again and again says, we want that education by which character is formed, the strength of mind is increased, the intellect is expanded, and by which one can stand on one's own feet. This is what is necessary. So when Swamiji was talking about the highest realization, the highest society, the better society, where all this truth will be practical, so the first he knew that it is not possible unless we help our boys and girls to develop their character. Unless we make this character building education, unless we propagate this education, only by stuffing all sorts of information in brains is not going to help. Highly qualified person can become a most corrupt, can become a most crooked person. He will have all worldly knowledge, he will have 10 PhDs, but he can be a most, you can say, the demonic person. Whereas the person illiterate, uneducated, if he has this dimension, he can never do anything wrong. That's why Swami Vivekananda says, bring light to the ignorant and bring more light to the educated, for the vanities of the education of our time are tremendous. We have to re-educate our educated people. What we see today in the society, everywhere scam, scandal, corruption, it is all done by so-called educated people. We are not able to educate our people with right type of education, and the effect we are seeing today. In the name of secularism, all great things, all good things, all morals, everything we have given up. We are not able to understand the real meaning of secularism. Here secularism means respect all, take good things from all religions, not discard everything. But now we see on syllabus, children, they don't learn all these things, except their subject knowledge, all these things are not taught. So how they are going to improve? That is what we say, the value education. Now government say we want value education. Now they are so much focusing on that. Because we are getting other things, we are getting comforts, but then human values are missing. So much of deterioration of the values. So here, because of neglect of spiritual values, neglect of spirituality. Though the parents should give their children what you say, samskaras. We have jatakarana, namakarana, then annaprashan, vidyarambha, all these things, samskaras are there. But then all these things nobody bothers. So only thing is, we are giving them education to earn more money, to enjoy life, and beyond that nothing. So everywhere so much of confusion, chaos, all problems, because this dimension is missing in our education. So here Sri Ramakrishna said, what is vidya, what is knowledge? Sa vidyaya vimuktaye. So that is the real knowledge which will make us free from all these bondages. That is what our sages have discovered. They have given to us that. That's why when the brahmachari, the students used to go to their ashrama, studying there, when they used to depart, there should be a convocation celebration. There they used to say, Satyam Vada Dharmam Charya Acharya Devo Bhava Matru Devo Bhava Pitru Devo Bhava Atithi Devo Bhava Swadhyaya Pravachanabhyam Na Pramaditavyam. So all spiritual instructions were given to them. Now your education is over, you go marry, you settle down in your life. But then don't forget these great values, Satyam Vada Dharmam Chara. But nowadays these things are rarely taught. And therefore, somehow or other, all wrong means we must earn money. Doesn't matter what methods we are utilizing for that. So this is not the way. If we want to make the society better, because ultimately we have a goal of life. We are all human beings. And for human beings, our scriptures, our sages, they have given that ultimate goal. What you say? Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha. These are the four values for human being. It is not meant for animals. So without practicing Dharma, how can you expect to realize the Moksha, to attain that Moksha? So the first step is Dharma. Practicing Dharma alone, you can attain the goal of life, that is the freedom. freedom for all bondages. So, but in Western society, neither they have dharma nor moksha. Only artha and kama. Just earn money and enjoy your life and don't bother about this because this is the only life. Afterwards, you will not get chance to enjoy. So let us earn plenty and enjoy and forget everything. So this is... So anyway, my time is going to become over. So here, Swami Vivekananda focus on these two points. Renunciation and service. These are the twin ideals of India. Intensifier in those channels and the rest will take care of itself. So we have to teach our boys to become a spiritual spirit of Tyaga and Seva. Swami Vivekananda said, everybody want to become a yogi. Just closing eyes in meditation and doing little pranayama, they think that sage should appear before them. So but it is not possible. It's only child's play. So it is a worship of Virata. So worship that God whose hands and legs are everywhere. So this spirit of service, seeing God in everybody, Shiva Bhavi Jiva Seva. First we have to make our mind pure, Chitta Shuddhi. That's why we must emphasize on this Seva Bhava. Even when the Satyakama went to Gautam Rishi, so he went there to attend Brahma knowledge, Brahma Jnana, the knowledge of the Brahman. But what his guru told? Take these 100 cows, take them to forest for grazing, and when their number will be 1,000, then you come back. Because he knew that this boy, he needs some training. Without doing some service, he will not be able to attain that highest realization. So go and make the 1,000 cows. This was the method our sages taught us, and that is what Swamiji wanted to combine. Our teachers should combine this secular and spiritual aspect, and they should imbibe in their life. That's why our Shastra says, Yadyada tacharati sreshta tatta deve tarojana sayat pramanam kurute lokostad anuvartate. Teacher should be role model. He should say, students, be punctual, come to time, but he is coming late. How students will listen to him? So he should be a role model. He himself should practice. Then seeing his example, students also will try to imitate him and they will assimilate all these great values, and that is what Swamiji wanted. We should have such society where all these values will be there, prosperity will be there. At the same time, we will have the ultimate goal of life, and by combining this both science and Vedanta, we will make Indian society a great society, a center in the world where the whole world will look towards India to have such type of society. And Swamiji had that bright future. He said, India is going to rise. I see clearly. It will become a great power in the world only because of these two things, science and Vedanta. The combination of science and Vedanta will make Indian society a great society, a better society. So since my time is over, I once again thank Swamiji for giving me this opportunity to share my ideas with all of you. Again, we will have one more session. So I conclude here. Thank you.
Thank you, Swamiji, for your brilliant presentation. You have chosen a very significant and relevant topic, but unfortunately we are running behind the time. So without wasting much time, I now invite Mr. Srinivas to present his paper. He will be presenting. He has come from Mumbai and he is the founder of Illumine Lab, and we will be going to hear more about this Illumine Lab from his presentation. So I invite Mr. Srinivas to present his paper.
No, that it has to be connected there. Or can you give me your computer? First of all, my pranams to all the monks here and the Matajis, and greetings to all those present here. The topic that I'm going to speak about today is knowledge society and its directions for the future. Excuse me, it's coming. Now, let me, before I begin getting into the details of the presentation, let me share with you my basic thesis and what is the core message that I want to share with you. If you look at what is actually happening in the world or the way things are emerging, and since the topic is directions for the future, and if you see the seeds of what is being born in the world, or all the seeds that are being born in the world, I think we are going to see at the end of this presentation that Swamiji is getting his work done anyway. In other words, the knowledge society as we see it is actually a significant step forward towards Swamiji's own vision of his own society. And I think that that society is being born in front of our eyes. And my whole objective in this presentation is to share with you what's going on in the world. If you see all the trends which are taking place, you will find that step by step we are moving irrevocably, irresistibly to the world that Swamiji anyway envisioned. And so that is the basis on which this entire conversation will take place. Oh yeah, now it's coming. I think now it's coming. So my strategy for the next half an hour is something like this. I will spend about 10 minutes or 7-8 minutes sharing with you what are the current trends that are taking place. So it kind of gives you a sense of what's going on in the world. We'll follow it up with another 7-8 minutes of speaking about what we think is beginning to unfold, and also about some fundamental new trends that have taken place which are beginning to point to the world that Swamiji has envisioned. And the last few minutes I want to speak about what it means in terms of our own relationship with and our notions of knowledge and our notions of what knowledge society really means are likely to get evolved or refined at the end of this half an hour or so that I will be sharing with you. So having said that, let me begin. First of all, what is the knowledge society is a big question. There are several definitions that people have used, but there are two or three broad definitions that kind of predominate. One understanding of the knowledge society is that it's a society where there is unlimited and access to information and knowledge of all kinds. In other words, there is, to give you a sense of the numbers, nearly 60% to 65% of the world's codified knowledge has been created in the last 40 years. That means mankind has created more than 50 to 60% of all codified knowledge in just 1%, less than 0.5% of its total history. So that is the rate of change in which knowledge is getting created in society. So very clearly this is having huge effects, and so that's one definition that people use of a knowledge society. There's a second definition that people use of a knowledge society, which is in terms of what is the dominant mode of production. So you find that, you know, the mode of production was agricultural, and before that there were hunter-gatherers, then there is agricultural mode of production, from there it moved to an industrial mode of production. So another way of describing the knowledge society is to say that the dominant mode of production, or the dominant mode of creating value in society, and the dominant way in which the structure of society is organized is around knowledge and its production and its use. So that's the second definition that people use of the knowledge society. There's a third definition that also people use of knowledge society, which is to ask that a knowledge society is one where we are operating, or we, our relationship with knowledge has changed. That is, earlier knowledge was really a resource for mankind. We were, if I had to earn more, build more assets or build new plants or industries, then I need knowledge in order to do it.
And now there is a fundamental shift taking place where knowledge has an end in itself, or it seems to be a goal independent of a material goal. So where the goal has shifted from a material goal to a knowledge goal. So that's another definition of a knowledge society. So all these definitions exist, and as you will see, they are really mere, they are not much of a distinction when you really see what is going on. So with this background, now let me begin. So these are some of the trends that are taking place. I'm not going to dwell too much on them because I presume that most of you are aware of it in some form or the other. One is that there has been a huge growth in communication technologies. It might interest you to note, for example, that more people have access to mobiles in the world today than to clean sanitation. That means more people can access a mobile before they can access a toilet. So that's the kind of spread that is taking place. Second, also along with it, there is a whole range of new tools, models which are emerging in the world, like Facebook, like Google, which allows you to search information, which allows you to connect with each other, and all of these are radically changing the way people behave, which you already probably notice in many households. You can see that a new generation of people are being born and growing up in a world where they're using these tools as if it existed forever. And so it's completely alien to an older generation, but it is the world in which a lot of people are being born into. Third, and this is more interesting, is that there is an explosion of what I call knowledge co-creation. Earlier what used to happen was that knowledge was being created by a few people, by a few experts, and this knowledge was being distributed in society. Even if you take publishing, for example, you needed to be a good author in order to get published, or you needed to be a journalist in order to have your things in the newspaper. So there was control over the means of production and dissemination of knowledge. But in the last 10 years, particularly 10, 15 years, almost anybody and everybody, if tomorrow you have a point of view and you want to share it with the world, it is possible for you to do so. You just have to set up a blog. It will take you just 10 minutes and you are on your way. You can express your ideas, and there will probably be, if you have interesting ideas to share, there will probably be a ready audience for it somewhere in the world. In other words, any one of us can become a creator of knowledge in our own right. We don't have to depend on some institution. We don't have to depend on an educational institution or a publishing institution or anybody in order to create knowledge and to share it. Moreover, there are people who are creating knowledge all the time on Twitter, on so on, and on various kinds of opinions which they keep giving on Facebook. So all the time, thousands and millions of people have begun creating knowledge simultaneously. That's a radical shift from thousands of years where only a few people have created knowledge. So in that sense, everybody has become participants in that knowledge society. Next, there is one more thing that is very clearly happening, which is that there is a huge shift towards knowledge-based work or knowledge-based workplaces. People use all kinds of data and IT for even basic work in organizations. So much of knowledge, so much of activity is getting ritualized or getting processized, as they call it, which is into standard things which the computer can do. This is having very, very big implications on work. Let me give you a very simple example. Your visit to a local bank, for example, or a bank branch. So much of that work has got automated today. And because it's got automated, basic errors that would possibly take place, they are much less likely to take place than, say 20 years ago, simply because they're all taken care of. And once that is taken care of, very clearly there are questions that are coming up, that what does a person working in a bank branch do with his time if anyway half his work is already taken care of by his computer? And these are real questions which are coming up, which is forcing people to rethink their roles. The same thing is happening, for example, in many of the today the beginning in higher end schools, but in other places, that if information is anyway available to students, then what is the role of the teacher in the classroom? So many traditional roles in society are getting questioned because all the routine parts of their work are anyway being taken care of by computers and by information. And not necessarily a bad thing, Because if you take up, for example, what Swami Srikantanandaji was talking about, which is the movement towards creativity, the minute you are freed of so much of the ritual of work, which is routine and humdrum, and if that the computer is taking care of, then it's very likely that you can be free to really talk about something or do something far more creative with your own time. So it's not necessarily a bad thing for technology to come there and to take away all your routine work. So that's one more thing that's taking place. Next is, of course, you know, even traditional manufacturing, for example, you are talking about intelligent home, CNC machines. I'm not getting into the details today, we don't have time. But, you know, there's huge changes taking place in everything that is, there's more intelligence, as they call it, but not really much of an intelligence other than artificial intelligence that is being put into so many devices so that they become smarter and better and they can anticipate things. Again, so much of the routine of life is getting taken care of in the knowledge society. And last is, of course, that there are whole new educational possibilities which are opening up. If I can have low cost content, low cost, in, for example, today you can see an MIT professor sitting in, you know, in any part of India without any difficulty. So these are all things which are taking place, which allow, for example, free access to knowledge and on, you know, content, educational content of various kinds. Now, all these are the trends that are taking place. So fundamentally, if you really look at it, we are talking about three things. Far more people are participating in knowledge. Work itself is getting knowledgeized. And there is completely new models of education which are also emerging. All these are the more fundamental trends that are really under, that you can see in society around you. And really speaking, if you really look at the growth of the society over the next few years, you will find that, you know, today there are more efficiencies, later there will be new models in which things are working in the world. Finally, you will find even many of your institutions and structures of society which today are not being born are likely to be, you know, very, very different in the knowledge society. Now, all these are taking place in any case. This is part of the general trend of technology, which is really, and technology and knowledge, which is sweeping all over the world. So far, so good. This is what you see as, you know, a continuance in one sense or the other of 400, 500 years of rapid technological growth that is taking place in society. All this is happening. Now, the question is that this is not the sum and substance of all that is happening. This is what we can see. But there is something much deeper that is beginning to happen. And that is something which we call the assimilation revolution. Beyond access to information, beyond all these external changes that you are seeing in society, something deeper is going on, which is that people are beginning to not just use information, but they are beginning to allow that information, or that information and that knowledge is beginning to impact human beings. It is impacting their own understanding of themselves, their own choices about themselves, and so on and so forth. And therefore, they are beginning to assimilate this knowledge. And this is exactly in the same sense of the word which Swami Vivekananda talked about, where he talked about saying that if you can assimilate five ideas, then you have more knowledge than a whole library put together. So it is true that people are beginning to recognize in the plethora of this vast amount of knowledge which is there, they are beginning to realize that really, if I want to make a difference in my own life, I have to do much more with it than just simply, you know, read it or use it. And my argument over the next few minutes or the next 10-15 minutes is to argue that this is already beginning to happen. Not obviously across society, but the germs are there, the seeds are there, and what it's going to mean is that over the next 20, 30 years, 40 years, if you look into the future and not look into the past, you will find that all this is really going to shape society as it unfolds. Now, in order to understand or to look at it, here is a simple framework which Swami Ranganathananda provided us almost 40 years ago, which is where he says that one way of looking at human beings is to look at them as being and function. So he says that, you know, being, the being dimension is where you're asking the question, who am I? And function dimension is where I ask the question, what I do? It's a very simplified vision of human beings which he spoke about. Now, this might be the tool with which we can probably try to appreciate or understand what I'm talking about. There is one type of knowledge that you see around in the world, which is function level knowledge. And there is another type of knowledge that you see, which is emerging in the world that people are asking for, which is being level knowledge. Now, I'm arguing that being level knowledge is not necessarily equal to self-knowledge. Self-knowledge is true, but then this might be a step in that direction, because it manifests itself in questions like, what is my purpose? What is my vision of life? What is likely to give me fulfillment? What is my sense of contribution? What is my meaning, or what is my vision for my own career? So these are all questions which people are asking, which are really asking them to reflect upon themselves and reflect upon their being, and to say that I have to question who is the person who is undergoing all these changes. In other words, this being level knowledge is in a sense a middle step, or you can say is part of that middle step, or the bridge between what you can call secular knowledge and spiritual knowledge. And that kind of knowledge has begun to spread in the world in a more profound kind of way. And this being level knowledge, I'm not saying is not equal to self, but it leads up to it. It's like a gentle ramp. And if we believe that all knowledge from aparavidya to paravidya is really not discontinuous, but is a single continuous stream, then this is part of that continuity, or it's a phase in that continuity. And as you go deeper, you might reach much, much higher levels of. And this kind of knowledge, people in the world are beginning to talk about and ask. And here are, for example, three drivers which are taking, and this I call the assimilation revolution. So the meaning of the word assimilation revolution that we are proposing is that when people are beginning to allow the knowledge society to help themselves question who they are, what is their vision of life, what is their vision of work, question their purposes, asking why should my organization exist, is it only existing for A or B reasons. When they are questioning all these things, when this reflective self-inquiry of some sort has begun to take place on a larger scale in society, on a more institutionalized scale in society, then something very fundamental is beginning to change. And this is important, because we all agree that all these questions have been asked for time immemorial, perhaps not only in the East but also in the West. It has been answered by lots of people have asked it, but they have been isolated. They have not been in the mainstream of society. And the point that we are making again and again is that all this is entering the mainstream of society. We don't see it fully yet. It's beginning to happen, but in 20, 30 years from now, you can be dead sure that it will be the mainstream of society. So what we take as something very far off today, which is the reflective questioning, the whole discussions about purpose, etc., are likely to be widespread in society in less than 20 years, or 25, 30 years maximum. And that's the kind of view that we are taking. So let's take each one to see what we are saying. How do I make this statement? First is, let's look at a shift in the way people think and learn. Yesterday evening, for example, there was a huge, there was a discussion that was taking place about the whole question of science and scientific thinking and scientific modes of thinking. Yes, that is, without getting into that discussion, there is another set of ways of thinking which are also emerging in the world, which are becoming increasingly important, and some of the best universities in the world have started asking these new methods of thinking. They call it design thinking, they call it solution thinking, but essentially what they are saying is, let us not necessarily begin our understanding of things from empirical knowledge. Let us not begin trying to hypothesize or begin with empirical knowledge as the truth. Why not we begin with what we seek to achieve in our life as the truth? That means if I begin with my own purpose and then I start looking and building knowledge, then an altogether different type of construct or a altogether different types of analysis might emerge. In other words, can I have knowledge which begins inside out rather than outside in? And that kind of knowledge, when if it is an inside out purpose which allows me to construct, I might be able to build completely different models in the world. And this is exactly what Swamiji did all his life in a way, which is that inside out he envisioned and built everything. He did not look at anything in the past in order to be a guide for his future. He might have, you know, taken learnings from the past for appreciating things, but it was completely from within that he really built something radical and new. And that's exactly what people are beginning to talk about. And this is in a sense true creativity, because it's creativity which you are beginning by beginning with an inside purpose as the basis for completely new thinking. And that is beginning to happening. And when I say beginning, the very same institutions, whether in the West or in India, many of them have begun to adopt these kinds of questions. And when I say institution, I'm talking about institutions like Stanford, like MIT in the West, and we are talking about, you know, many, many organizations in India, many philanthropic organizations are beginning to say that maybe we need to solve society's problems differently. And this is a new way of thinking and learning. So this is becoming more and more accepted, which is separate and from the traditional. I'm not at all arguing that this is, but this is a completely different way of thinking, which is not necessarily empirical based or anything. It is solution based, human based, based on the way you think about what purposes people have. The second kind of change that you see is also institutions, corporations, collectives are beginning to ask the question, what is our purpose? What is our vision of life? And when I say this, I've you know, kind of kept three books there just to give you a sense of the kind of writings that are coming up. The language is not what we are familiar with, but it is there. There are people who talk, for example, about shared value. What are they talking about? They are talking